This video has been brought to you by the Research School of Chemistry at the Australian National University. Today we'll be comparing electrochemical couples and ranking them in order of their standard electrode potential. The five couples we'll be looking at are for iron, tin, bromine, iodine, and manganese. We'll also be making use of chemical indicators such as potassium thiocyanate to detect species in our reactions and draw conclusions about each of the couple's electrode potential from the results we observe. Part 1. Comparison of bromine and iron couples. Take your iron 2+ solution and add it into a test tube. Today we'll be comparing the solutions using the indicator potassium thiocyanate. Thiocyanate turns a dark bloody red in the presence of iron 3+, and you can see in the test tube on the left what it looks like when no iron 3+ is present. Now we're adding in some bromine water to our test tube with iron 2+. When we add the potassium thiocyanate, the change in colour will indicate whether or not iron 3+ has been formed. As you can see, the solution has turned very dark red in comparison with our start solution of just iron 2+ ions. Now let's put a solution of iron 3+ into a third test tube and then add some drops of bromide ions. In this instance, we'll test with thiocyanate ions again, but because we started with iron 3+, a dark red solution indicates no reaction has taken place because no change has occurred. Now we'll use our bromine and iron couples to set up an electrochemical cell in the fume hood. You will need bromine water, two 100ml beakers, a solution of iron 2+, two carbon rods joined by a copper wire, 4 molar hydrochloric acid, a large piece of filter paper, tongs, and gloves. Fill one of your beakers with 25ml of bromine water and 25ml of hydrochloric acid. To your other beaker, add 50ml of iron 2+ solution and a few drops of potassium thiocyanate as an indicator. Have one rod in each beaker connected by the wire. Fold your filter paper in half and moisten with 4 molar hydrochloric acid, being very careful not to touch the solution. You can't touch this. You can't touch this. You can't touch this. Once your paper is moistened with the acid, place it between the two beakers and this will act as your iron bridge. We'll leave this setup running and check back on it later. Now that we've investigated the relationship between iron and bromine couples, we will now investigate the relationship between iron and tin. Our first experiment will involve iron 2+. Have a look at your notes and think about which tin species would be appropriate. That's right, tin 4, which means that we will also be comparing iron 3+ and tin 2+. Add a few drops of your iron 2+ solution to a test tube and a few drops of your iron 3+ solution to a second test tube. Now add your appropriate tin species to each respective test tube. We will again be using thiocyanate ions as an indicator for these reactions. Make sure your tin is added in excess. This is so we can ensure all iron 3+ ions that might be reacting with the tin get reduced. After a minute or so, it should be evident whether a reaction has taken place. Remember that thiocyanate ions only tell us whether or not iron 3+ is in the solution. Whether that means a reaction has taken place depends on what you put into the test tube to begin with. Take a moment to think about what your results mean and rank the standard electrode potentials we've determined so far. In part 4, we'll compare the electrochemical couples of iodine and iron. To your first test tube, add your free iodine solution, I2. Now we'll add iron 2+. To the second test tube, add your iodide ions. Follow this with a few drops of iron 3+. In this experiment, we'll be using the organic solvent dichloromethane as an indicator. When iodine is dissolved in dichloromethane, it turns pink, so we're looking for a pink color in the dichloromethane layer. Now we'll be adding dichloromethane to our second test tube to determine if I2 has been produced. It's a bit hard to tell because of the dark color of the original solution, but if we hold this test tube up to the light, you can see that the bottom layer is violet. By now, you should be able to determine the relative standard electrode potential of most of your couples. But there's one more comparison we need to carry out in order to rank the iodine couple with certainty. Iodine and tin. To your first test tube, add a few drops of your I2 iodine solution. We'll again be using dichloromethane to compare these two experiments. To your second test tube, add your iodide ions and add some more DCM. We will now add the appropriate tin couples to each test tube. In the first test tube, add tin 2+, and in the second test tube, add your tin 4+. Remember that dichloromethane tests for the presence of I2, and have a think about what it might mean to see it disappearing. Our final experiment today is a comparison of the bromine and manganese couples. Add a few drops of your potassium permanganate to your first test tube. Look how beautiful that purple is. Now add drops of manganese 2+ ions to your second test tube. To each test tube, add the respective appropriate bromine species. This experiment doesn't require the addition of any chemical indicators because potassium permanganate is a beautiful deep rich purple while manganese 2+ ions are colourless in solution. Keep in mind that bromine water is orange to begin with. You should now be able to rank all 5 of your couples against each other. Before we wrap up, let's go back to the fume hood and check on our electrochemical cell that we set up at the start of the lab. As you can see from the thiocyanate ions we added, iron 3+ has been formed in the right-hand beaker. This has been enabled by the iron bridge and the copper wire allowing electrons to flow between the two solutions. Remember at the end of every lab to tip your waste into the appropriate waste container, making sure you read the label. You should now have enough information to rank the 5 couples that we studied today in order of their standard electrode potential. Keep in mind what the indicators we used were actually testing for, and think about whether that means a species has changed or stayed the same in its solution. Good luck, and a huge congratulations from myself and the other tutors and demonstrators for making it to the end of the first semester labs. You've all done a tremendous job, especially in these trying times. And we hope to see you back in the labs as soon as we can. You can't touch this. You can't touch this. Can't touch this. Can't touch this.